Start recording. All right. Well, welcome back. It's been a while since we've all been together. Today we're going to cover Facebook for churches. We're going to look at some best practices for Facebook in terms of how to design your Facebook page, and also in terms of the content that you put out on Facebook. So some of the things that we'll be looking at are communications basics. There's just some things that are common to all social networking platforms. I want to make sure we go back over. Then, like I said, we're going to look at Facebook page basics. We're going to look at messaging. And then I'm also going to talk about some geolocation services related to Facebook and some other social networking sites. So with that, let's look at some communication basics. One thing I want to remind everybody, whether you're talking about Facebook, your website, Twitter, whatever, that content is still king. That whatever it is that you're messaging, you want to make sure that you're adding value to the conversation. Don't just put out information so that you can be putting out information. And I know sometimes that's when you're strapped for content, that's a hard thing to do, and sometimes you feel like you just have to get something out there. But in everything you do, try to make sure that your content is information that your audience is looking for. And knowing your audience will help define what kind of content you're going to put out there. And it also not only defines what you'll say, but also how you'll say it. The information that you put out to your Moms to Moms group and the vocabulary that you use for that is going to be different from what you put out and the way that you say it for your high school middle group or middle high school group. Middle school group, that's what I'm trying to say, thank you. So anyway, just be aware that, you know, in what you say, you always have to think from the perspective of the people that you're putting the information out to. How are they going to perceive the information, and how are they expecting to receive it? Also, knowing your audience not only shapes, you know, the text and the words that you'll use, but also graphics, pictures, and videos, for instance. So now we're not looking at generational issues, but also technology issues. If you live in a community where most people have broadband, then you can include a lot of video. But if you're in a community which is predominantly DSL or even dial-up, then you're going to have to limit those pictures and graphics. And you can include links to videos, but don't embed them in your message. Make sure that they're someplace else somebody can go to them, you know, when they can have access to higher bandwidth. Also, you want to make sure that, again, if your audience is mobile or has bandwidth issues, you want to keep your messages. Text isn't so important to keep short, but you need to keep your images small and video short. But again, if your audience is mobile, you want to keep your text messages short, not because of bandwidth, but because you've only got a small screen space for people to work with, and you don't want to have to have them do a lot of scrolling as they go through their messages. Some more communication basics. You know, let's remember our publications calendars, where we keep all the information that we're going to put out through all our different messaging channels. Make sure that you post events that are appropriate to your audience. Now, if you're in charge of your church's Facebook page, then obviously everything going on in your church is something you need to message. But if, in addition to that, you also manage a page that's specific to a particular ministry, make sure that the messages you put out on that page are relevant to that ministry and not just, you know, copying and pasting every message over to that ministry, because you may be putting information out there that they're not interested in or would confuse them and wonder what it is they're supposed to do with that information. General practice for Facebook is post at least twice a week. Once a day is better, and I know for many of you, this is something you're doing as an also part of your job description. It's not your primary focus. It's something that you're taking on as a you know, as an additional task. And posting something once a day can be really difficult, especially if you're the person who has to generate the content. For that, all I can say is, you know, when you can, try to enlist some help or look at your content and see, you know, for instance, if you're reposting information from the Sunday bulletin, do you need to post everything that was in the bulletin on Sunday? Do you have to post it on Monday also? Or is it possible that you can spread it out during the week? Now, obviously, the more time-sensitive the information, the sooner you need to get it out. But you might have some evergreen information that can be posted at any time, so you can save that for later in the week. But in all you do, at least, like I said, try to make sure that you post at least twice a week, if you can, just so that people get used to seeing posts from your page so that it stays fresh. And again, going back to your publications calendar, schedule posting for those times when it's convenient for you. If for whatever reason Thursday is a slow day for you, then Thursday should be one of the days that you update your Facebook page. And then also update your communications matrix. And this is a two-way street. Looking at your communications matrix to see, are there messages that we're already communicating to particular audiences through different channels, and we should add Facebook to that messaging system if it's appropriate. If your audience isn't on Facebook, then don't add it to the matrix. But if you're already using an email blast system in the Sunday Bulletin and it occurs to you, well, the people who get email, all of them or pretty much all of them have Facebook, then add Facebook to your communications channel. The other thing is also look at the messages you're putting out on Facebook and on a regular basis and see, well, is there stuff that we're putting out on Facebook that we should also put out through other venues? Maybe there's something in the Facebook that we should now start adding to our email blast, or we should start putting on our church's web calendar. So it's a two-way street with that. So anyway, this is all stuff that we've covered in far more detail in other presentations, but I just wanted to remind you, it's been a while since we've covered some of this information, and it's all still relevant to Facebook messaging. So with that, let's get into some Facebook specifics, and let's look at Facebook page basics. And by that, recently, it's been a few months now, but Facebook has done a major interface change to what their site looks like, and it's in particular Facebook pages. Instead of just a giant news feed now, we've got those big picture graphics that take up a lot of the screen space. And so I just want to spend a lot of time right now looking at some things that some of our churches have done with that large billboard space, I like to think of it, and some creative things they're doing with it. Now, first example, here's Hope Church. And what I would like to say with this picture is just that it's, depending upon who you are, this can be a very inspiring or engaging picture because it engages your imagination, it engages the senses because of its use of color and such. And that is primarily the goal of this large picture, is you want to make an emotional engagement with the person who's viewing the image. And that emotional engagement can happen in a variety of ways. And here it's a large scene. Like I said, there's not a lot of detail in this picture. And even though the cross is there, only occupy a small part of the screen, because of the way they're placed and backlit, they become the focus of this much larger image. So, again, I just thought this was a creative use of imagery and color here. Evangelical Presbyterian Church of Marshall, I'd like to point out a couple things about their page that I thought was rather clever. First of all, being in the lower left-hand corner here, I want to look along the bottom here. You've got several, it used to be tabs. They're still referred to as tabs, although you don't tab on them anymore, or they don't look like, folder tabs. But in the lower left-hand corner here, Evangelical Presbyterian Church of Marshall filled out their profile in the About section, which tells people about their church. And I thought that was really good that what they did, they didn't just write text to fill the screen, but they talked about who they are and who they are in their community, which especially if you have a seeker-oriented church, the people viewing your page will want to know, well, what are you about? What are you doing in our community? What are your core beliefs? What kind of programs and activities do you have going on? And, in pretty short form, they covered all of that in their description here, which I thought was very good. Not to saying that you have to copy that exactly, but I'm just saying they made good use of that space rather than leaving it blank. Now, going to the right a little bit, we've got a welcome tab there where it says Facebook, and this is left over what the symbol here. This is the old FBML, Facebook Markup Language, which is no longer in use. But Facebook has, even though you can't create FBML pages anymore, if you had one, they'll still display it. And so EPC of Marshall had a welcome tab that they had put together, and it's still there. And I thought that was great that they created a page specifically with a welcoming message that supplemented what they had in their About section. And then what was good about that is that Since we're kind of outward seeking, we're looking at visitors. In addition to a welcome message, make sure we have a map available so it's easier for people to find us. Now, something else I thought that was interesting about their page, if you look here, and I've not seen this anywhere else on Facebook, is that they used a collage of images rather than just one huge image. They've got these pictures of trees and flowers and wheat and someone praying. Now, my only thing is that I don't live in this community. I don't know this church, so I'm not sure how these pictures relate to their church. And I guess if you're someone who attends the church, these images might have some meaning for you. But without knowing anything about the community, as someone coming in from the outside, these pictures don't really do much for me. They don't tell me much about your church or why these images are there, so they leave a big question mark. But, you know, maybe that's explained, and again, maybe the people in the community, know why these images are there. So the point I'm trying to make here is if you're going to do a montage like this, or even just in the images you're going to use, make sure that they speak to your audience, that someone outside of your church understands what these images are about. If that is the focus of your Facebook page, is to attract people from outside the church. If your Facebook page is primarily to communicate inward, then you still need to make sure the images are relevant, but very likely people will understand why the images are there. Now, the other thing I'd like to point out about this page, which normally I think would be very clever, is right underneath the church name, they've got their web address, which for 10 years I had my own business doing website and social media consulting, and I would tell all of my clients that, if you put your web address wherever you put your phone number, put it on your building, your truck, your receipts, anything, make sure your web address is out there. So normally I would say this is a good idea, except that Facebook's guidelines for your profile page is that you cannot put contact or promotional information. You may not put your email address, you cannot put your phone number, you cannot put your web address or anything like that. So now I have not seen anywhere in their guidelines what repercussion there is of doing this. So I don't know if you'll just get a warning that says, hey, in 7 days you need to have this removed or we'll take your picture down, or whether they'll shut it down and say, you've got to send us a picture and someone here has to review it before we'll approve it. But anyway, just something that should be changed here. Oh, and I'm sorry, I should have mentioned again, if you've got questions or whatever, I've got everybody on mute, but if you shoot me a question or a chat message, I'll address that. Now, Lake Forest Church here, now this picture, I like this for two reasons. Number one, again, the purpose of this picture is to create an emotional engagement with the person viewing it. And people are most likely to engage with pictures of people. So here we've got some people in the picture. Now we can't see their faces, but we see them there, hands raised in worship. So there's people here that are doing something that I might want to, I'm speaking as, a stranger coming to this page. I'm looking at this and I'm seeing that these people are lifting their hands up in praise. So if that speaks to me, then this is a church that I would probably want to attend. The other thing I thought was neat is that unlike the other graphics we've looked at so far, which are in focus and clearly defined, this one intentionally has the background images here blurred, which, I don't know, again, this is me personally, it's very subjective, gives it a not just an artsy feel, but also I'm not so focused on the detail of what's in this picture as opposed to being focused on what is the activity of this picture. So here the photographer intentionally took out detail to focus what the picture is about. And I thought that was very interesting juxtaposition there. The other thing I liked about this, in the lower right-hand corner here, where the events page is, or the events tab, my eye actually was drawn to that first simply because of the use of bright primary colors. And I'm not saying that you have to use bright primary colors. I'm just saying that that's where my eye just fell because of that. I mean, you can put any kind of picture there for your events, and I just thought that this cartoon image was very clever the way it was used. Now, Reflections Church here, they've got a lot of the same things we've seen before here. They've got the map. They've got a photo here. It's got people involved in some kind of activity. So, again, there's an engagement here. But actually, why I wanted to talk about Reflections Church is about the content of their page. And for that, I'm going to unmute one of our guests here, Pastor David Goble. Here you are. All right. Can you hear me, Dave? David?
Yes, I can.
Okay, David. All right. Well, yes. Welcome to the show, and thank you for the webinar. Thanks for joining us and being a volunteer here. But what I want to talk about and why I asked David to be on the webinar with us is because Reflections Church puts out these thoughts for the day, which are these large pictures on a variety of different topics. But with them, I'm going to let you, David, why don't you tell us about your thoughts for the day here?
On our website homepage, we have a feed at the bottom of the page that puts up a scripture of the day. That's a service we subscribe to, and I just got to thinking that I often and other people often will check and see what that scripture of the day is, just for inspiration or whatever. And typically throughout the day, I'm mulling over some thought or some idea, mostly from my own devotional reading, or some place where I'm at in my own journey or things I'm thinking about. And I try to find ways to capture that thought or that feeling through some of the classic devotional writing or contemporary Christian literature, just a succinct, to-the-point kind of thought. And then I try to find an image that captures the sense or the feeling of that thought in almost a kind of a Zen-like, a very simple, but to the point illustration, so that as people look at the image and they contemplate the thought for the day, it really, really somehow speaks to them.
Okay.
Hopefully it will.
And how long have you been doing these thoughts for the day?
Probably a couple months now.
All right. And your original inspiration for, you explained the use of the images, but your original inspiration for putting the thought for the day out on your website was what?
Well, just a sense of, you mentioned earlier in the presentation about wanting to post relevant content that connects with your audience and the people you're trying to reach. And we're a young church of about 6 years old, a very eclectic group, and some with long-standing faith backgrounds, some with very new experiences in faith. And so I've tried to find ways to connect with and speak to where that eclectic group might be on any given moment, and just speak to the larger emotional and spiritual concerns of where people are at. For example, the screenshot that you've got up right now with the quote from Teresa of Avila, we have a lot of people going through a fair amount of stuff in their life. We as a church have been through a lot, some challenging times lately, and I was just thinking about Teresa one day and her sense of being at peace in Christ, and so I went on a hunt for a quote from her that would sort of capture that a little bit.
Okay, and I see you attribute the photo here to Scott McDaniel. So, I just wanted to touch on that a little bit. That you've familiarized yourself with copyright issues, so you try to attribute photos wherever you can. Is that correct?
That's correct. In some cases, there's no indication that there's a copyright on the picture, or just a Google image or something. In this case, this is somebody I know. In another case, the one I did more recently with the hummingbird in the hands was copyrighted by a photographer in, I believe it was in California. So I went to their website and found an email contact and just shot him a quick email and said, here's how I'd like to use your picture, here's the quote I'm going to pair it with, may I have your permission to do that, and got an email back shortly thereafter with a very positive response. And so sometimes you can do that. Other times, you know, obviously they're just kind of random out in the public sphere. And so far it's worked out okay. I hope we never, you know, inadvertently cross a line and get in trouble. But we try to pay attention to that to the extent that we can.
Yeah, and I would think that a lot of photographers or graphic artists would actually be just thrilled that their artwork was going to be featured anywhere, you know. So, that's great. Now, have you found that any of the images have gained particular traction? You know, some image or message, you know, wasn't so popular, but another one just, you know, totally blew you away with the number of comments or likes that you received?
Yeah, I think that messages that tend to deal with really trusting God in the midst of uncertainty or life's challenges or difficulties seem to resonate a lot more with people than just other topical kind of thoughts and themes. And I don't know exactly why, except that it maybe just sparks more of a personal chord with people.
Mm-hmm. And now, are most of your comments about the thoughts for the day, or do you ever get any comments about the actual image?
Occasionally, yes, we'll get a comment or two about the image, and we don't get a lot of comments. I mean, you can see in that screenshot, there's the comment below the one with the dock going out into the water. She says, "No man is an island." In which case, that could be, you know, a comment both about the photograph and the quote itself.
Mm-hmm.
But occasionally I'll get a comment, something to the effect of, "That's a very powerful image," or "It speaks to me," or love that picture," or something like that. But typically the comments tend to be more about the essence of the thought for the day.
Okay. And I'm always interested in repurposing, so I have to ask, have any of your sermons ever generated a thought for the day, or more interestingly, thought for the day ever generated a sermon?
That's a good question. I don't know. The lines are so blurry between them. That I don't think about it. There probably is an interplay between the two, but they both grow out of typically where I'm at any given, you know, week or moment.
Okay.
So.
All right. Well, will you be able to stay with us till the end of the presentation?
You bet.
Okay, great. Because I'm looking at the time here, I got to get moving on here, but people might have questions for you afterwards. So. Okay, well, anyway, thanks for being available and being able to give us some insight on what I thought was just a really creative use of Facebook here. So, okay, I'm going to put you back on mute here. All right. Now, this is Word Church, and what I thought was really interesting here, well, two things. First off, in the lower right-hand corner, this is the one of the few churches I saw that was doing something with video. And Word Church has a communications department, and they do a lot with video. If you check out their YouTube channel, they've got dozens of videos on a whole variety of topics. Most of them related to you know, the messages that are going on at their church. So their YouTube channel is very it is predominantly inward focused, but they make those videos available through their Facebook page to make it easier for members to find them, and also for members to share them with friends who aren't attending Word Church. But I also loved this page graphic here for two reasons. Number one, obviously, unlike what we've seen earlier, which is traditionally photography or some other kind of graphic, here an artist did some work, or somewhere somebody did some work, and pulled these black and white graphics together. So I just thought it was a very interesting use of black and white imagery. And since we're talking about prophets, which is Old Testament, we had these kind of woodcut images in this artwork here. So I just thought it was a very nice way to tie the graphic to the message series that they were doing during the summer, which I've highlighted here. That was their summer message series. Now, and I think that's very clever too, that they're changing their Facebook profile picture based on the messages. Now, if you're a church that has a lot of graphic artists who have a lot of spare time, you know, this is something you can afford to do if you do your messages in series, but most churches do their messages in like 3 or 4 message series, which means every 3 to 4 weeks you need a new image, and that's a lot of time from either one person or a lot of people working as a team. Unlike, though, if you're doing a longer series like this or like a church I attended, we went through the book of James, and it took us like 3 months to get through the book of James. You know, it'd be real easy to put up a graphic for something like that, because you've got 3 months before you have to do something else with the page. So anyway, just a couple of clever things I thought Ward did here. Now Faith Church, and we have many Faith Churches. This is Faith Church in Rochester Hills, Michigan. And a couple of things about this picture. Now, like I said, you want to create an emotional engagement with the person viewing the page. So now if the idea of this page is to be outward focused, to people beyond our church, then this picture probably doesn't create that kind of emotional engagement. Now, because of the design of the building, it does kind of create an intellectual engagement because of the angles in the roofs, the symmetry of it in a couple different places. So it does create kind of an intellectual curiosity, and it also helps, you know, it's a contemporary design, so you get an idea that this might be a more contemporary, you know, worship service then, which happens to be the case. But now on the downside, though, is that because you get a picture of the building, this building is set far back off the road, and unless you're looking for it, you might not actually see the church. And the other thing is that this is the side of the building that faces away from the road. So to use it as a picture to help people find your church wouldn't work, because actually what people see is what's on the other side of this picture. Also, me personally, I would have taken the van out of the picture. Since the focus is the building, I would have wanted to see more of the building and the doorway there and got the van out of the way. But on the flip side, though, what I thought was really, really clever about this page wasn't the profile picture, but the avatar, which is the smaller square picture here that I have the arrow pointing to. What you have a picture here is of the road sign, because like I said, this church is set back off the main road, so and because of the landscaping and such, you have to pretty much look straight up the driveway to see the church. You can't see it as you're approaching it, because there's buildings or trees in the way. But they have a large road sign. Faith is in big letters, so it's easy to see. And so every time they post something to Facebook, this avatar is going to appear there. So if you are a visitor or someone looking for a church, it's going to be very easy for you to find them, because you'll have seen in the stream their road sign many, many times. And the other thing that I thought was clever, now it's kind of small on the screen here, but if you're actually to visit their page and see a larger version of the picture, the website address is on the road sign, which again, kudos to them. Every time I talk to a church, I encourage them, if you don't have your web address on your road sign, you need to, so people who are driving by can find you on the web and learn more about your church. So, you know, I thought that was great that they have their web address on their road sign, but also they've got the web address on their avatar. So again, every time they post something, their web address is up there for people to see. Now, even though Facebook has a policy about no promotion in the Facebook picture, it doesn't have anything that I've found about the avatar. So by design or not, they've found a way around the Facebook restrictions. So, again, some issues I have with the larger picture, but the avatar I thought was just clever. And Cherry Hills Community Church, now I like this because they put their motto, their slogan right out there. Community is our middle name, because it is Cherry Hills Community Church. So it's kind of clever, because it is a joke, or a pun, not a pun so much, but it is kind of humorous the way that they pull out community. But also it's a statement of who their church is. Now they've filled out their about text there, so you can read more about them. And they also have a welcome page there, and I'll show you that in a little bit. But even if you don't read those two things, they've told you right up front, we're about community. Now community can be defined to different people. different ways, but at minimum, you get an idea that they have a sense of belonging together, whether that's in activities, whether that's in the worship or the prayer groups that they have or whatever. Somehow they're about getting people connected to people. And you can read about that in the About text. Or now their welcome page, we saw earlier a church that had a welcome page, and it was the old Facebook markup language. Now here they've got a picture of a house, so they created a welcome page not using the old FBML, but they used there are several freely available applications that will allow you to create Facebook pages. And I'm sorry, I don't have a list of them, but if you do a Bing or a Google search on Facebook page applications, or if you just go into the Facebook website, they have a page there for applications to either create applications or applications that already do something you might want to do. But if you click on that welcome, it takes you to this, and you can see this doesn't look like a Facebook tab at all. I mean, this is very customized like they have here. And again, they repeat the welcome message. They've got, join us there on Sundays, and they list their service times and, chapel service. They've got a map you can click on. Again, all the essentials of, if you're a seeker-oriented church and you're looking to invite people in, then this is where you would find all of that information. I'm sorry, I'm just double-checking to make sure. I think I've lost my sound. Nope, it looks like I still... Okay, anyway, getting back to the presentation. Now, Green Tree Community Church here, I liked this picture because, like I said, for me, it's about making that emotional engagement, and here you've got people... And I don't know if this was a community work project or a mud fight or whatever, but it's just real people. We're not in our Sunday best. We're not doing a portrait picture. This is just kind of, spontaneous type picture. Now the three guys on the left there, they're kind of scary. I don't know. They're a little intimidating, so they might have wanted to pick, a different audience here. But, I just thought this was, we're real people is what this picture tells me. And again, depending upon the kind of people you're looking to bring to your church, this picture alone can, bring people in that you never thought would come in simply because it is so inviting. Now, another thing I'd like to point out about Green Tree Community Church, and the same can be said of First Presbyterian Church of Loveland, which is also on Facebook, in the lower right-hand corner here, the notes page. And Facebook notes is sort of like Facebook's response to blogging, and that it allows you to type very long messages. Your status updates that you do are limited to 420 characters, but your notes, I'm not even sure what the upper limit on that is, but I've seen some really long posts where I've had to scroll through the screen a couple times because there was so much text. And what Green Tree Community Church is doing and First Presbyterian Church of Loveland is that they're posting... I would say they're pretty much sermons online. Now, they may not be text of last Sunday's sermon, but they're something that you can read through and use as a Bible study. And they do these on a weekly basis, so once a week. And I did talk. I didn't get to talk with the pastor at Green Tree Community Church, but I did talk to the person who does the Facebook update, and she said that sometimes these notes are related to the Sunday service, and sometimes there's something different. And sometimes they're done in series, and sometimes they're just one-off messages. So it's there is a lot of variety there in the type of notes that are read. But they say they get a really positive response from these, and so the pastor continues to dedicate time to creating them. So and I know for many of you, again, either you yourself are under-resourced, or your pastor is, or you might be the pastor doing Facebook who's doubly under-resourced, and doing something like this on a weekly basis would be just, too much of a time commitment. And I'm not, in no way do I want you to feel pressured that this is something you need to do, because again, it goes back to knowing your audience. And I would say that if you've got tons of spare time on your hands, and you know that your congregation is not looking for that kind of communication from you, then don't put the time into it. On the other hand, if you know that your church is looking for something like this, then all I can say is you'll have to look at, you know, all of the things that you do and figure out if there is a way that you can rearrange your priorities, or if there's any way that you can get someone to help you with that. And like I said, I just don't want you to feel pressured that you have to do all of these things I'm showing you. What I'm trying to present here is a collection of what I think are some really great ideas that you can employ as you figure out which of these ideas fits your communication style and fits the needs of those who are looking at your Facebook page or Facebook pages. So now with that, we spent a lot of time looking at the Facebook page, the profile. Let's look at the messages that actually go on your Facebook page. And there's seven different things I'm going to look at here, so let me try to get through these in the next few minutes. First off, finding your voice, and I've talked about that a little bit, but again, you have to figure out what is going to be the voice for your Facebook page. If you have a small church and people know that you're the person who updates the Facebook page, you actually have a lot more flexibility in what you write, because people know that it's you writing it, and they can read these posts the way that they believe you would say them. On the other hand, if you're working in a larger church, or like me working at the denominational office where very few people know me, I have to keep it more professional. I cannot interject a lot of my personality into it and such. So I just have to keep in mind that I'm writing more from a newscaster standpoint than I am from a one-to-one personal communication. But also, something else that helps you determine your voice is the kind of content. You know, are we going to be strictly just news updates? Am I going to be more Bible study oriented, which means not only just writing Bible studies, but putting out, you know, cool links to Bible study resources that I find. Like we saw with the Reflections Church, their thoughts for the day, are we going to put some thought-provoking questions out there? Or do we want, you know, questions maybe that don't offer an opportunity for reflection so much as they offer an opportunity for debate? We're intentionally going to throw out controversial questions, which, you know, that can be a minefield to go through something like that, but just something to think about. Or are we going to be about our community, or you know, are we going to speak more through photos and videos than we are through text? Listening is important in creating good messages. You want to look at what do people react to, and unfortunately I don't have time to go through Facebook insights here, but all of your pages, as an admin, you should be familiar, there's an insights opportunity which shows you which messages people are engaging with, and you can actually click on individual messages and it'll show you how many people saw your message and then how many people saw that message because other people saw it. And that's called your viral rating. So you might put something out and 100 people see it because you posted it, but the friends of those 100 people might be like 7,000 people, which would be, you know, a great viral, you know, rating, versus maybe 100 people saw it, and of those 100 people, only 3 of their friends bothered to look at it too, so it didn't achieve a viral rating. But anyway, the point is there is to look at what people are reacting to and determine, do I want to continue with that kind of messaging and drop other kinds, or do I need to continue with everything that I've been doing, recognizing that some of the content isn't going to gain traction with, you know, a large part of my audience, because just because it doesn't gain traction with a lot of your audience doesn't mean it doesn't have value. You might have a very niche section of your audience that looks for a particular kind of communication, and you know, you're meeting their need, which is the goal of communication. And then, you know, looking at the, you know, first off, you look at, you know, what are people talking about on your page? What are they reacting to? And then as you have time, and again, that's always a difficult one, finding the time, looking at the personal pages of the people who have liked your page. I've found that I'm now getting a lot more views and likes and comments on the EPC's Facebook page because I've started repurposing or reposting the content from a lot of our churches that are on Facebook. I see these things and I repost them, and occasionally I do comment on them. I keep it to a minimum, but occasionally something strikes me that I really need to, you know, say something about, and so that has also, because I've got this new fresh content coming in and I'm talking about things that other people are talking about, that's improved the visibility of the EPC's Facebook page. Use simple questions. If you're going to post a question on Facebook, you want to keep it as simple as possible. not to say that the topic has to be simple, but don't make long-winded, complicated questions with multiple options unless you're taking a poll or survey or something like that, and you let people know up front that, you know, hey, I'm taking a survey. And there is a survey and polling tool that you can use. Actually, there's several that you can use with Facebook. And that can be a lot of fun to do something like that. But primarily, unless you're going to get involved with these other applications, you want to keep your questions to a yes, no, true, false type of response, because the less thinking people have to do about the response, the more likely they are to actually respond. So if you keep the responses simple, you're likely to get more responses. And then, you know, asking people to like or dislike a particular comment as a way of helping to vote or make a decision about whatever it is that you posted. And also, you know, if people do, you know, if they go beyond the yes or no response, if they actually offer some kind of commentary with their answer, acknowledge it. You know, at least, you know, put a, you know, hey, thank you for your message, or thank you for your thoughts kind of thing. If that's all you have time for. But, you know, make sure you acknowledge that kind of comment. It validates that person's, well, I shouldn't say validate, but it acknowledges the time that that person put into their thought. And it also encourages other people to go ahead and make comments as well, because they know people are you know, you as the administrator are reading their comments. But if you do have the time, go beyond the thank you and actually respond to whatever it was they commented on. And, you know, if you're just swamped, if you don't have time, but if you see that, you know, comments and such are piling up, you're getting a lot of likes or dislikes, you know, just put an, I'm really busy this week, but I'll get back to you next week kind of thing. And then just follow up on that. So let people know, oh, hey, yeah, somebody is reading my comments. They couldn't take the time today, but they're going to get back to me. So great. I feel like I didn't waste my time in leaving them a comment. Unique content links are also great messages. You know, now, like I said, I'm reposting a lot of stuff that churches are posting, so the content isn't necessarily unique, but it is unique in that I am now cross-pollinating our churches, that, you know, something going on in the Presbytery of the West is now being seen by people in the Presbytery of the Mid-Atlantic and such. So, you know, there is that way of posting unique content. But the other thing is that you might want to look at, you know, content that instead of uploading it to all of your social media avenues or uploading it to your webpage, maybe you only want to upload it to your Facebook page as a way to help drive traffic to your Facebook page. A great example of this would be if your youth group were to do some kind of work project in the community and somebody took a video of that, go ahead and put it up on the youth group's Facebook page. And depending upon, you know, your church, maybe you want to say, hey, if you want to see this great video, if you want to see, you know, what these kids have been doing, then go to their Facebook page. And the thing is that if the page is public, you don't have to be on Facebook you don't have to have a Facebook account to go see that video. Now, I'm not saying, you know, to start siloing all your information and to hide essential information. If there's something that's of value to the entire church, then yeah, post it everywhere. And you know, what the youth group did should be, you know, acknowledged and celebrated by the rest of the church. But that doesn't mean that it necessarily needs to be everywhere. And this doesn't apply just to Facebook, too. You can do the same thing with all of your other communications channels. If you're trying to drive traffic somewhere, just try to come up with that content it makes sense to put it in this particular social media venue like Facebook and really promote it there. Other unique content, you know, we've been talking a lot about pictures like photographs and such, but, you know, charts and graphs are things that people react to as well. And there you can ask people, here's the results of the survey. Do you agree or disagree and why kind of thing? Or do you think that these results are bogus? You know, that might be a great piece of content to put out there. Here's a chart, and I think this information is totally, you know, the way they conducted the survey was completely wrong. So, you know, maybe they should have asked, you know, everybody in this group instead of asking people who are only in their 30s kind of thing. So that's a way to generate some discussion and get traffic to your Facebook page. Be clear with instructions. state your call to ask action. If you want people to comment on what you put on Facebook, then make sure you say, please comment. Don't just make that assumption that they will. Also, if you're putting out instructions related to an event or something that's, you know, has a deadline, completely spell out the deadline. Because when you say something's due next Monday, the first question is, now by next Monday, do you mean this Monday coming up or the Monday after this Monday coming up? Because I'm never sure what next Monday means. And also, depending upon when they're looking at this, one of those Mondays might have already gone by. So now I'm not sure which Monday we're talking about. And also, you know, many people put the date, but it's good just to put the day with it so that way I don't, oh yeah, August 27th is Monday, not Sunday. I thought it was Sunday kind of thing. So just be very clear with instructions. And then, you know, if at all possible, get someone who's unfamiliar with your ministry or your project to read your instructions to make sure they're clear to them. So someone who doesn't have any background can understand exactly what it is you want done. Respond and interact. We've already talked quite a bit about this, but, you know, like I said, when people leave a comment, honor that by responding to it, even if it's just a thank you or I'll get back to you later. Now, sometimes it may be like if you ask people to vote yes or no on something and you come back over the weekend, it's Monday, and you look and you're like, you got 100 responses. You can't thank, unless you have a lot of spare time, you can't thank all 100 people for their responses. So you thank them as a group. It's like, hey, I'd like to thank everybody who voted over this weekend. We really appreciate the feedback. You know, and then, if again, this one takes a lot of time, but if you can, interact with other people's posts, meaning that, you know, don't just interact with the stuff that's on your Facebook page, but when you see people who are commenting on your Facebook page, go to their page and see what they're talking about and maybe get involved with that, as long as it's relevant to, you know, the discussion that you're having on your Facebook page or it's relevant to your ministry or, you know, what it is your church is working on. And then humanize your message. Now, earlier on, I talked about the fact that for those of us who are managing a church web page, you do kind of have to take that news broadcaster style of impersonal communications. But that doesn't mean that your Facebook page has to be impersonal. We can humanize it by including photos of people with announcements. You know, like if we're going to announce, you know, the church barbecue is this Sunday, that's fine to announce that. But if you can, get a picture from last year's barbecue and put that with the picture, so it's like that way people have a visual image to go with the event. Use action shots rather than the portrait type photos, because action always speaks louder than inaction, or almost always. Now, like the picture of Green Tree Community Church, now those people are obviously posing for a picture, so that was not an action shot, but based on some things you can see in the background, plus the amount of grime they had on them, obviously some kind of action occurred. So we've got a post-action shot, which is almost as good as the action shot. In that instance, I thought the post-action shot was better because you've got people looking at the camera and they're smiling and you can, you know, engage with the smile. And, you know, regularly include a message from staff member or volunteer leader if at all possible. And again, this is where you're going to have to recruit people to help you. But, you know, you're putting out the event information, the church news, you know, the service, the special project was canceled due to weather, that kind of thing. If you can, get a staff member or a volunteer leader to write up something that you can put on Facebook about the particular ministry they're working in. You know, if you're looking for volunteers in the children's ministry, now, okay, that's one thing to put a post, we're looking for volunteers in the children's ministry, the call to help, that's fine. But also, if you can, get posts from one or two or three people talking about the joy they have of working in the children's ministry. I mean, that's really the best way to recruit is, you know, taking that Huck Finn approach. This is so much fun. I'm not going to let you paint my fence, you know, unless you pay me a quarter kind of thing. So if you can get people talking about how much fun it is to be involved in a particular ministry, that's your best recruitment tool is a testimonial. So, you know, or, you know, if you can get the pastor or one of the elders to do kind of a state of the church type, you know, quarterly address, that's a great thing to put up on your Facebook page also. Okay, claim your place. I got to talk really fast here. Okay, first off, Facebook lets you, there is a way on Facebook to claim a, first off, let's talk about your profile page. Make sure that you've got the full name of your church there. We have a lot of First Preses, we have a lot of faiths, a lot of cornerstones, a lot of hopes. So make sure you identify which First Presbyterian church you are. Spell out the name completely. get all your contact information into your profile, your service times, and all that kind of thing, so people know where you are and when you're meeting and how to contact you if they have questions. It's also great in either the About section or in a special welcome message to talk about what to expect on Sunday. You know, some things that people always want to know, the dress code, how long am I going to be there, and that kind of thing. And if you've got any extra amenities, those are always great to mention. So, you know, you can put something like, you know, hey, join us on Sunday. The dress code is casual, the music is contemporary, and the coffee is free. You know, so you make it very, you know, casual, the tone that you put it in, and you let people know in a very nice way what to expect. And then you can go into, you know, our services are about 75 minutes long. You know, never put a precise number. It's always about or roughly or that kind of thing. And then if you do have multiple Facebook pages, make sure the Facebook pages link to each other. I'm just amazed at how many nonprofit organizations and churches don't do that. So make sure you cross-promote. On Facebook, if you go to facebook.com/help/location/claim, you will find this set of frequently asked questions. And the first one is, how do I claim a page that already exists for my business, or how do I create one? Because Facebook has a special places section, which it regularly goes through postal service and phone book information and creates pages for places, businesses, and that includes churches that already exist. So your church might already have a Facebook place page and you don't even know about it. And so you want to go out and claim that page, and that way you can control the information that's in it. And if it's not already there, make sure you create one so that that way you own it. Some other geolocation services like CitySquare, Foursquare, Google Places, LinkedIn, TripAdvisor, and Yelp, and there's many others, but these are some of the big ones, have a similar kind of thing. If anybody from your church has a LinkedIn account and they mention that they're a member of your church, they're on staff at your church, whatever, LinkedIn immediately creates a company page. So again, you'll want to get on each of these different either websites or social media services and go out and claim those pages and make sure that those pages link to your website. And if you, since we're talking about Facebook, if you've got a Facebook page, make sure that those things link to your Facebook page too. You know, wherever you can, this is your opportunity to promote all of your different internet presences, because each of these things helps improve your search engine visibility. So that's another good reason to make sure you claim this information. But the primary one is to make sure there's accurate information about your church out on the web. And then facebook.com/username. If at least 25 people have liked your page, you can get a vanity URL. So instead of being facebook.com/EA7 2462GK whatever.html, you can become facebook.com/firstpres of wherever you're at. So it just makes it easier for you to promote your Facebook page if you get that vanity URL. So if you don't have that already, make sure you go out and grab that. Wrap up. So we went over some communications basics. We looked at what I think are good examples of Facebook pages from our EPC churches. I very rapidly went through things that help you with your Facebook messaging. And then just an admonition, never stop learning and experimenting, because Facebook, as we've learned the last 2 years, changes frequently. So things are always changing. New tools are available. And there's, you know, plenty of blogs to read about, you know, how to use Facebook. Surveys coming up. Want to let you know that October 22nd, I'll be doing a webinar on how to use surveys in your church. If you think that's a dull, boring topic, please tune into this, because I'm going to change your mind on that. Surveys are one of the greatest things you can use, one of the best tools out there to help you improve your ministry service. And then we talked a little bit about copyright today when David Goble was telling us about the photos he uses at Reflections Church. I'm going to be talking about copyright in general, what you need to do to protect the copyright, the intellectual property of your church, and how to make sure or do your best job to not land in legal hot water from copying other people's text and pictures and such. Want to let you know, we finally have a dedicated page for all of our resources here. So if you go to the EPC main website, click on Ministries, go to Christian Education and Communications. We now have a page there for church resources, church communication resources. And then finally, I'm trying to collect pictures of all of our churches for Pinterest and Flickr. I'm developing photo albums. So if you have a really good picture of your church, please email it to me. I'd love to include it in our Pinterest and Flickr accounts. If you go out there, you can see some of the images that people have sent me. We've got some people have been able to capture some really nice images. So, okay, I've managed to leave a whopping 3 minutes for question and answer. So let me find my controls here. I can get everybody unmuted. If you've got questions, now's the time to fire them off. I see David is still with us, so if anybody has questions for him about what he's doing at Reflections Church with Facebook page, this would be a good time to ask. And I always like to ask, what did anybody think was the most useful tip you got out of this?
I was wondering if the notes area is a good place for a pastor blog.
Oh, well, now when you say a good place, you mean instead of doing a blog, or?
Yeah, well, I'm not real familiar with blogging, other blogging sites.
Okay. If you're already on Facebook, Facebook Notes would be a good place to get your feet wet and started with blogging, because it has that ability where you can post longer messages and then people can comment on it, which is essentially the main function of a blog. But if you were investigating blogging platforms, I always recommend WordPress. I think is a great platform, but I know a lot of other people use Blogger and blog post as well. And if you're willing to invest some money, TypePad can be another. That has a lot of tools, but I don't believe TypePad has a free option, so there's some minimal charge with that.
Okay. I think, claiming the place page and all those other options there, that was real helpful for me.
Oh, good. Yeah, I was surprised to find out how many of these services actually go out and create pages for you. So once I started doing some investigation, that ended up, first off, between the hunting them down and filling out the information, that was about 2 hours out of my time to make sure that the EPC's home pages were nailed down everywhere I could find. Yeah, we're at the 1 o'clock mark. I know a lot of you probably have to get on to something else, but I mean, because I went so long there, I mean, I'll stay on for another 10 minutes or so if anybody has other questions or would like me to go back and review anything in more detail.
On my Facebook page, there's something called Join My List, and I clicked on it and it just went to nothing. Do you know anything about that?
No, I don't. I've never heard that. Join My List. I'll have to look into that.
It actually says, sorry, an unexpected error occurred.
It must have been now, did you inherit that Facebook page from somebody else? Or
no, I started it quite a while ago. So it was probably in the old format and got switched over when they, I don't know, what they migrated their pages or.
Okay, that very well could be. It joined
my
list.
I'm wondering, can you go there and see if you can see it?
Sure, let me take a look here. Okay, oops, here, I'll just go here. Let's see. Okay, and which church are you with?
It's a Sierra Presbyterian Church.
Okay. See y'all, Sierra. By the way, thank you for sending me a picture of your church.
Oh, you're welcome.
Okay. Huh, I don't have you in my Facebook list. Oh, we've got to change that. Okay.
That's it.
That one there. Yep. Recognize the picture. Okay, let's like you. There you go. Okay, and where do you have... Oh, join my list. Hmm. Okay. It looks like this application has been installed, but not configured.
Okay.
Would be what I get from this. So you'd have to go to your administrator panel and look for applications. Let's see. If I go back to my page. That help. Edit page. Let's see, is it under admin roles? No, wait, you know what? I think I'm in the wrong menu. Nope, that's the right one. Okay, applications over here on the left. Leave this page. Okay, this shows me all the applications that I have installed. So if you do the same thing and go to apps, you should find a Join My List application. That, based on the text of the message, my guess is that it's just not configured, but it could be, like you said, it might be an old app that's been deprecated, so it's not available anymore.
Okay.
All right. Let's see. All right. Other questions?
Dana, this is Dave Goble. I have a question, but it's off topic, so I'll wait till we finish up.
Okay. Facebook question or just general communications?
It's a more of a technology, use of technology in
Okay.
Presentation.
Okay. Well, I still have Cecilia, Rick, and Sandy online. Do any of you have a question, or could I take David's question?
That sounds good to me.
Okay. All right. Let's hear the tech question.
Okay. So I've been to some larger conferences over the last few years in which the presenter has a technology set up where they will take an on-the-fly survey in the middle of their presentation or sermon, and they'll ask you to text your response to a certain number that's up on the screen, and within a very few seconds, the results of that survey appear on the screen. And I just was wondering if you had any, I know there are services out there that you can, I guess, subscribe to, but just wondered if you had any either experience with that or advice about where to go to find out more. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do. I've actually been through three of those surveys, and they are kind of fun, except unless you're somebody like me who has a phone that doesn't text, or until recently. I admit that for all my experience and training and such in technology, and I used to be a computer programmer, my cell phone has always been about 10 years behind the bell curve. just this last December, I finally got a flip phone with a camera. My
nice.
Kids are like, wow, that's what my middle one actually said. That's almost as cool as the babysitter's camera. So, on the other hand, though, my wife totally picks up my slack in that area. I have been through three of those surveys, and it is kind of cool to see. Now, in two of them, they waited till the survey was quote-unquote done, and then they flashed up the results. But one of them was kind of neat. You actually saw the votes as they were tallying up.
In real time.
Yeah, and I'm like, well, that's kind of cool, and that's kind of an interesting way to influence the audience that hasn't voted yet. So, no, I'm sorry, I can't make any recommendations or, gosh, even point out where to begin the research on that, other than going to a search engine or you know, whatever it was that you were at, if you have the speaker's address and you can ask them which service they use and why they selected it.
Okay.
That'd probably be the best way to go. Now, if you don't mind my asking, which conferences were you at where you saw these things?
The one that I remember more recently has been, one I went to several years ago was a Church Planters Conference Exponential down in Orlando.
Okay.
The one more recently is a men's ministry called Men at the Cross, kind of Promise Keepers-esque kind of experience.
Okay.
And the presenter was asking some questions as part of his message that evening, and he asked all of us to respond, and they had it up in pretty close to real time. It was within, you know, 30 seconds or whatever the results appeared on the screen. And the thought that just occurred to me is, one, it's, you know, it's highly engaging and interactive, but two, it's a way for particularly people who are not you know, long-standing people of faith, people who are new to this or just exploring it, to, you know, to kind of get their feet wet a little bit and actually having an interactive experience with a faith-based conversation.
Okay. Well, yeah, I would be really interested in looking at your research after you finish it and what you decide to do with it, because that's something potentially. I mean, I can't see us using it for a business vote at General Assembly, but certainly during some of the workshops before the business sessions, that could be really interesting.
Yeah.
So. All right. Sandy, you have a question? Let's see. Question. Oh, wait. Questions are down here. Just a minute here. Let me grab this question. Oh, yeah. Just so everybody knows, the webinars are recorded. So sometime tomorrow, I will have the recording of this available on our Vimeo site. And I will also have the slide presentations in a PowerPoint. So those will be available as well. And you can find these at that epc.org/CEC/EPC communicators address. Or like I said, go to the EPC website, click on Ministries, from there click on Christian Education and Communications, and then look under Church Resources or Church Communications. So, sorry, I just noticed that hand was raised there.
Dean, I just wanted to let you know that Join My List on Facebook was actually a Constant Contact add-in.
Oh, okay.
I see that now.
Oh, okay, thanks. So was that something you meant to add and forgot to finish, or was that something you accidentally clicked on?
No, I added Constant Contact a long time ago, the app, onto my Facebook, but I've really never done anything with it.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah, like I said, from the message, it looked like something that was installed but not configured, so.
Dan, this is Dave Noble.
Yeah. Yep.
I don't know if folks are familiar with the instant share, social network share button at the bottom of your Constant Contact emails, but it makes it pretty easy to take that email that you're putting together and post it to your Facebook, your Twitter, wherever you want to just instantly share it.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, that was the app that I installed, was the ability to do that.
Okay.
I don't think I have it installed on our Facebook page, but when I create an email in our Constant Contacts window and I get ready to send it, I go down to the bottom and there's a button there called Simply Share. and I click that, and I have to specify a few parameters and stuff, but it pretty quickly posts it to our Facebook page. Maybe there's something happening automatically that I'm just unaware of, but I'm not a real tech-savvy kind of guy, and it was fairly easy to do.
Oh, good. It sounds like maybe I need to do a webinar here in the future on mail distribution lists like Constant Contact and MailChimp and things like that. Might be useful.
We sure love it.
Okay. You using Constant Contact?
Every week.
Okay. Yeah.
We send out a newsletter every week, and so we use Constant Contact for that.
Yeah, our Women in Ministry group uses that also. All right. Well, I think I'm going to let you guys go, and I'm going to go finish my lunch. So anyway, thanks for being with us today. Again, David, thanks for being here so I can pick your brain. And Cecilia, as always, thanks for your comments. You've always got great stuff to add. So,
thank you.
Anyway, I will hopefully see you folks in October then, or at least get a chance to chat with you when we talk about surveys. Like I said, spread the word. You'll want to make sure everybody tunes in for that one.
Thanks, Dan.
Okay, have a good day.
Thank you, too.